IVM.
Welcome to All Things Policy, a daily podcast by the Takshashila Institution. We are a bunch of policy nerds based in Bengaluru, and we like bringing fresh perspectives to Indian affairs and Indian perspectives to global affairs. So grab a cup of coffee, sit back, and join us for today's chat.
Hello and welcome to All Things Policy. In today's episode, we are going to talk about labor regulations and reforms. This has been a matter of debate and discussion for a long time now and has been specifically in the news for the last few months, with some states taking massive steps. To discuss this with us, we have Mr. Anupam Manur, who is a faculty and researcher at Takshashila Institution. Welcome, Anupam.
Hey, thanks, man. This is probably the first time you ever referred to me as Mr. Anupam Manur, so it's got a nice ring to it.
Okay. Yeah, that's nice. So, Anupam, in the last few months, we have had some labor reforms led by some states. Why don't you tell us why we need labor laws in the first place?
Yeah, see, I think the India's labor regulations are... it's a symbol of everything that is shambolic about India's economy and has been for some time. It is, it is the single thing which is always pinned down as what is preventing India from becoming a modern economy which can, clock, double digit growth, etc. Right. So, and I think, there's a fair bit of truth to that as well. It's labor reform. I mean, labor laws are onerous in India. I think anyone who's been following the debates on structural reforms or ease of doing business, etc., I think will know that, the first thing that economists say is that we have to change our labor laws. Right? So I think these things are known, and we can take, multiple kind of instances of how this has been preventing firms from growing, etc., and what are the exact consequences of our extremely complex labor laws. But before we go into all of that, I think we should just characterize India's labor laws, right? One, India's labor laws are archaic. Basically, most of it was done, post-independence, but there are some, the Industrial Dispute Act or the Factories Act, one of them, I'm not sure, goes way back to the 1800s. Of course, it's been amended since then, slightly here and there, but, you still got to think that the main mindset is before, is around that period, about 70 years back at least, if not sometimes, as I said, more. So, that is one big aspect of what's wrong with our labor laws, right? That is, it's archaic. Second, it's complex. It is incredibly complex. I mean, just compliance with some of these labor laws adds, sometimes as much as, 35% to a firm's cost. So that's how complex these labor laws are. And it's not just, 35% is just an India, all India average. But if you look at, there's large variations within states as well. In Bihar, for example, if a firm has to comply with all of the labor laws, it adds as much as 69% of their cost, right? And that's not trivial in any standards. That tells you about the complexity of the laws. Third, they are contradicting in nature sometimes, right? And it's that there are too many of them. So just to give you an idea, there are about 40 central laws, or rather 40 laws which are done by the union government. And then there are about 100 laws which are done by the different states. So, if I think most of you would know, our listeners, that labor actually falls in this concurrent list. So both the union and states make laws on labor and labor relations. So there are about 40 union laws, 100 state ones. And then there are about 1,100 acts which define labor, and about 58,000 compliance regulations, right? So it just gives you an idea of how many laws there are. And you can also readily imagine that if there are these many laws and acts and regulations and so on, they are also bound to be contradicting in nature. So there could be, for instance, one law which is done by the union government, one by the state government, and they could tell you dramatically opposite things, which means that a firm can never be 100% compliant. Even if you really want, there's no way that you can be compliant. So these are, I think, the large problems with the labor laws. Of course, we can now, these are all the, the really serious aspects, but now you can take, if you don't mind, just a few of the really funny ones, if you please. Now, there's, for firms which are actually trying to comply with these laws, there's nothing funny about it at all. It is, far from funny, but for us as, neutral observers. I'll just take two or three examples if you don't mind.
Yeah, yeah, definitely.
Yeah, there's this thing called the Factories Act, right? So the Factories Act of, and it was passed in 1948. Again, just note the year that it was passed, and it'll immediately tell you why these things are funny today. So the Factories Act basically aims to safeguard, you know, workers' health, safety, and comfort in you know, any factory or any plant where the workers are employed. Now, of course, this is noble intentions as always. But now look at some of the rules, right? And how fastidious and how intricate these laws are. I mean, this is the perfect example of, you know, your nanny state trying to be overbearing and over, you know, it's burdensome to and ridiculous extent, right? So in some states, in this part of this Factories Act, the rules prescribe the frequency of how many times you have to whitewash the toilets in the factory. And by the way, that is every 4 months. And then it also has regulations on the size of the buckets required to fight fire. By the way, those are, any guesses? 9 liters. Then there are rules which elaborate on the specifications of the spittoons. Okay. And if anyone of you don't know what a spittoon is, actually, you know, applaud that, because there's no reason why in the 21st century we should know what a spittoon is. But a spittoon is basically where you spit out your chewed paan and other things, right? So a spittoon has to be made of galvanized iron. It has to have conical funnels. And it has, you know, it has to be at least be placed on a stand which is 3 feet high, and there has to, you know, and there's also rules about how frequent they should be, every X number of meters. I don't know what that X is, because that varies from state to state as well. So, give you an idea of how overbearing the regulations are, right?
I mean, since these regulations are so overbearing, that also means it gives extraordinary powers to the executive, right? So they will have a lot of discretionary power, and this can have a major bearing on the industries.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. And eventually that's what will happen. If, you know, I mean, I think all of you would have heard of the term Inspector Raj. And I think by and large, that comes from these kind of regulations, not just labor, but, you know, on every single aspect of it. So what this essentially means, if you have these many complex kind of regulations and rules, then there has to be someone who executes all of them. And that will be an inspector. Now, the inspector goes around and says, and as I said, there's no way any firm in the country can be 100% compliant with these rules, right? So which means that there is always scope for rent seeking. And that is exactly what happens. An inspector can come about and, you know, essentially take a bribe. Because there's no way that you're going to be following all the rules. So, and that led to an entire complex political economy of the inspectors ruling over the factories, and, you know, basically factories which, you know, are always at the mercy of these inspectors.
Yeah, apart from all these funny aspects, some of the serious aspects are also, I mean, controlled by the government, right? Many of the things which market should typically have the freedom to decide, it is all delegated to the governments. Like, I was reading somewhere that in case for all those formal employees who have more than 100 employees, if they want to change the tasks that they assigned to their employees, they have to take the approval of the state. I mean, every other day, for day-to-day activities, for the day-to-day operations, you have the involvement of the government, the state and the government here. So again, how the markets will operate, there is restrictions on freedom. So that is probably the reason why labor regulations reforms are long overdue.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. So one of the things that gets the most attention, and probably rightfully so, is that a company which employs a firm with the factory which employs at least 100 people, 100 employees, cannot fire people at will. So even if you have gross incompetence, and let's say a person who's just not attending, etc., you need to take the government's permission to fire a person. So you need to write in letter saying, this is the reason why I'm firing this person, and I seek your permission to fire this person. And then the government will obviously take its own time, its own this thing. And if all of this we're saying is done with integrity and honesty, right? It still takes time, because there has to be a bureaucrat who has to review the case, because if he does something wrong or she does something wrong, then again, there will be consequences. So everyone wants to be extra careful. So essentially, firms can never hire people. So you can imagine the kind of, you know, the effect that it has on productivity, right? If you are, it's dead weight that you're carrying around, and there's nothing that can be done about it. So all of these, and this is just what we've been speaking about for the last, whatever, 10 minutes or so, is all just the tip of the iceberg.
We have just looked at it from one angle, how these regulations have impacted the firms. But if you look at its impact on the laborers, I mean, they are supposed to protect the interest of the laborers. Like, but have they been successful in doing that? I mean, just in India, more than 90% of the laborers are not under the formal net, right? So they don't have any such safeguards.
You're right. In fact, it is not just that it has not helped the majority of the laborers, but it has actively sought to reduce the welfare of the laborers. And let me explain why that is the case. Because these labor regulations are so onerous and so overburdening, most firms prefer, obviously, not to be under these regulations. So now every single of these regulations kicks in at a particular level, right? So for instance, this hire and fire rule that we were speaking about would kick in only if you employed 100 laborers, right? And so you have, and this is really funny, if you look at a statistic of how many factories in the entire country have exactly 99 employees. You would be, you know, it's mind-blowing, right? Because every single factory would like to hire exactly 99 employees so that they don't come under this particular rule. And then the rest of them, they actually have contract labor. And that contract labor doesn't, you know, none of these rules apply to the contract labor, right? There's no benefits, there's no social security, there's no, none of these things that, you know, you've enacted in order to protect the interests of the laborers. So what you've done is, in fact, completely created almost like a black market for labor where none of these rules apply and every single firm is completely incentivized to stay under this kind of black, I mean, it's not really a black market, but because the rules allow for it. But it's this kind of shadowy market, if you please, right? It's a gray area. So, you know, I mean, this goes back to one of my favorite kind of adage or saying, which was, I think, initially coined by Gurcharan Das, which is, says that India grows at night while the government sleeps, right? So, you know, you do everything when the government sleeps because you don't want to come under the rules of the government because it's so restrictive in nature. And so that's the reason. And if you look at this Factories Act, for example, some of these things come into effect at 10 employees. So again, the number of firms with 9 employees is massive. Number of firms with 99 employees is massive. Number of firms with, you know, again, 199 employees would be massive, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, right? So what all of this has resulted in, and let's look at from both sides, from the firm's angle, you have an active incentive not to grow. Because once you grow and you hire more people, you're going to bear the burden of compliance. So you don't want to grow. You want to stay, you know, small. And therefore, I think most of you would have also heard of this famous, again, this term or coinage called the missing middle, right? So in India, you have a whole number of firms. The largest majority of firms are extremely small and they're deliberately small so that they don't have to come under labor laws. And then you have just very few who have the political will and the money to break free from all of this. And they are extremely big. So you can think of the Reliances and Tatas and Birlas. These are the really extremely big firms who hire lakhs and lakhs and lakhs of employees. And then you have the really small, you know, your cottage industries with 9 employees or 14 employees and 25 employees, etc. And what you have the in between, there's this massive missing middle. We don't have factories with 5,000 employees, for instance, because there's zero incentives to reach that height.
Yeah, it is in this context that the recent reforms seem significant. I mean, there's a crisis situation. And again, the states have to take massive steps to boost their economy. They want to attract investments. It is in this background that some of the reforms that were initiated, but some of the states brought about some changes in the labor laws. So in this context, if you look at it, they might seem significant. The state of Uttar Pradesh and Madhya Pradesh, they were the first ones to roll out some changes. Uttar Pradesh has exempted the industry from all major laws except for maybe 3-4, which are related to women, children, and bonded labor. Madhya Pradesh initiated laws according to which you can easily hire workers. You will not have factory inspection for 3 months. You don't need to register for 50 laborers. And again, other states also followed. For example, Gujarat, again, they have a provision for the next 1200 days. All these provisions that I have been talking about, they have some sunset clause here. Uttar Pradesh is for 3 years. Madhya Pradesh is for 1,000 days. Gujarat is for 1,200 days. Gujarat also exempted new industrial units from multiple laws, but some of these laws will still continue. Minimum Wages Act, Industry Safety Act, they will remain in place. The other major laws, the new industrial units do not have to follow. So what do you think, Anupam, is going to be the impact of this? Is it going to bring about massive changes? And again, some commentators have actually raised questions about the process, about the timings of these changes.
Yeah, I mean, so there's a lot to unpack in what you said. Initially, I mean, let's take a step back and say that, obviously we all know that even though, you know, everything that I said is widely known, it's not that I'm giving unique insight at this point. Pretty much everyone knows the problem with our labor laws. But yet it's one of those things that's just not been touched. Even in 1991, when we had these big scale reforms of everything else, you know, in the product market, we had zero reforms in the what you would call as factor market, which is basically labor and land. And these were two things which are just untouched because the political economy surrounding it is extremely tricky to navigate. And all politicians know this. So, you know, they've always kept a respectful distance, if you please, from these things. Now, jump back the clock. And there's been various attempts at reforming some of these things. We can go through an history of, you know, these things, but it would be too boring. But major landmarks, I think we have to mention is Rajasthan took the first step, you know, because they felt it was crucial in kind of delivering the growth. It's a useful case study for various reasons. Not that it was extremely successful, but at least it kind of paved the way for some of these things. Now, Rajasthan took the first step under Vasundhara Raje in 2015, if I'm not mistaken. Essentially, they just changed a couple of laws which, increased the limits for, under which, you know, the firms would fall under these laws. So before, if it was 100 employees and you'd come under the Industrial Disputes Act, now they just raised the limit to 300 employees. And once Rajasthan did that, I think that was a kind of a game changer in that many other states started to follow suit. It was, you know, very small, incremental, and so on. And even this particular government, for instance, has been kind of, has at least had a inclination to try and change some of these rules. So, for instance, they wanted to, you know, codify all of the labor laws into four codes, right? So all of the, let's say about 40 odd that we said union labor laws into four codes, one on wages, one on industrial relations, one on occupational safety, and one on health and working conditions and social security, right? Four or five codes, I lost count. But yeah, so that's extremely important that you're trying to codify. Now, they succeeded on the code on wages, which was passed. Of course, it had its own problems on minimum wages and so on. But let's not get into that. I think most anyone who's read anything that I've written would know that I'm against minimum wages in the strict sense of the term. But that was passed. I mean, at least they, you know, were able to simplify a lot of those laws. But the others have been stuck and could not get through. Now, all of this was before the pandemic, right? There was small incremental changes being made. There was genuine attempt to reform some of these things. And then the pandemic hits, right? Suddenly you have 124 million people when the lockdowns were announced, you have about 124 million people out of jobs, right? In April. And so this led to a crisis. Suddenly, even the most traditional socialist or left-leaning politician in India, irrespective of which party they're from, I always say that every single party in India is left-leaning in economic terms, not necessarily in political terms. All of them suddenly changed their color and realized the importance of making some of these reforms, right? So you had a whole bunch of states, 9, 10, 12 states at least, who took the lead on making these reforms on labor. So, as you mentioned some of them, Gujarat, Madhya Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh, they took some of the lead. Karnataka tried to do something. And suddenly the pandemic forced their hands. And they made these drastic changes. Now, the problem, according to me, so if you're going to ask me, you know, whether it's effective, whether it's a good way to go about things, etc., the problem is exactly that it's too drastic, right? So, one of the, I think, very genuine criticisms is that this, as much as it's required, labor reforms, etc., this is probably, you know, bypasses all the due processes of a democracy, right? And there's something to debate there one way or the other. I mean, I think some people would say, and I have no position on this, to be honest. Some people would say that it was long overdue. You probably have to, you know, some of these reforms have to be done with the with that kind of brute force. Some others, you know, will obviously push back and say, no, it has to go through the due process, etc. I'm not going to take a stand. I'll let the readers kind of take the stand on this particular aspect, right?
Yeah, and one thing here, I mean, already the Industrial Relations Code has been tabled in the parliament. So what is the need of an ordinance? So that can also be one more issue here. And again, definitely the stakeholders were not involved. And obviously you cannot include the stakeholders when at that time when you are undergoing a lockdown. So yeah, it's something which is can be controversial. And apart from that, if you look at the regulations which have been eased, okay. So one is hiring and firing of workers. So many states have tried to ease this process. And this is something that economists have also been talking about, that this is something which is a major constraint for industries. But then there are some other kind of regulations, right, which are related to occupational health, safety, or working hours. Now, these have also been reduced, or the scope of the laws which govern this have also been made they have been reduced to some extent, they have been made defunct. Now, shouldn't there be a balance here? I mean, hiring and firing of workers, those who are incompetent, yes, you can. But when it comes to the occupational health part, the safety part, at least some minimum standards need to be maintained, right?
Yeah, you're absolutely right. I mean, even completely economically conservative or pro-market economists would say that you have to find that balance. I mean, you cannot, for instance, in the name of labor laws or reforming labor laws, you cannot forego of basic human rights and dignity and some of these things, right? So you have to look at working conditions. Now, they're clever and more intelligent ways of doing this. Even the inspection, I mean, I think inspections need to be done in order to look at, you know, whether workers are exploited. You can't go back. See, in the name of reform, you can't really go back, you know, 400 years back to, you know, bonded labor kind of situation, right?
Exactly.
So you have to look at whether there's basic human conditions are met for the workers, and I think that is a must. And you can't have, you know, in a factory with dangerous, let's say, equipment that is being operated, you can't have a person working a 12-hour shift, 12, 14, I don't know what the number is, but where they're essentially tired and they're prone to making mistakes and errors. And that can lead to, you know, massive industrial hazards, right? Not just for an individual, but, you know, for everyone else, their colleagues, and probably, you know, sometimes it enters city in which it's located in. So, depending on the industry, of course.
Yeah.
So, I don't think some of those things can be diluted, which goes against human rights, which goes against basic, you know, decency, and which goes against, I think, common sense to some extent. So, I think the government got a bit carried away saying we're going to exempt factories from all forms of labor laws for the next 1,200 days. I think the one big problem was that they didn't think through the implications of some of those things. I think there's very real chance that people could be hurt because of that. So there's some things you can dilute, and I think we should. Some things you can't, and so you got to find that balance for sure.
Yeah, and this 1,200 days, 3 years, again, different states have had different provisions. And this is also something I feel can impact investments. I mean, one of the purpose why you are trying to dilute the laws is you want to attract more investments. But all of them have sunset clause. So whether we should call this major labor reform, because if you're talking about reforms, means this is something which is going to, it is going to change for an indefinite period, right? But here or everywhere we have the sunset clause, and again different states are having different laws here. So again, if you are setting up your industry in, let's say, Gujarat, but if you want to set up another base in MP, the laws will be different. It will come under some other jurisdiction, and the same benefits that you're probably getting in one state you will not get in Gujarat. Also, another issue when it comes to investments from outside. How important are labor regulations here? I mean, there have been multiple studies. World Bank has its study. In fact, Niti Aayog, IDFC, they have also done different studies. And they find out that labor regulations are important, but definitely they are not, at least the survey that they have carried, they find out that labor regulations are not the major bottleneck to investments. There are multiple other factors which are more important. For example, political stability, macroeconomic stability, policy consistency, those kind of things. And whenever you are having a sunset clause, and given the fact that India has had retrospective taxation and all these things, so again, whether it will give confidence to the future investors, that is also a question.
Yeah. So again, this you've raised at least 3 to 4 points that you know need addressing. One is the limited time period for the relaxation of the norms. I think that was a terrible way to go about things because no investor, and I'm going to quote, actually, let me not say it in my words. Let me quote Arun Panaghia in a particular Times of India column who wrote that no entrepreneur worth her salt will invest in a sizable enterprise if she faces the prospect of the current labor law regime returning in a period of whatever, 1,000 days or 1,200 days. So, right, that's a quote unquote. So, I mean, that makes sense. You're not going to make a massive investment because the labor laws are relaxed now, only for it to return in 2 years or 3 years' time, right? That just doesn't make any sense. So, you want that policy certainty, as you mentioned. So, that is definitely, I think, one of the wrong ways to go about the sunset clause on the relaxation of labor laws was probably wrong way. I mean, a better way would be, as I said, a little bit of consultation with all the stakeholders and then passing these laws, you know, without not the ordinance way, but actually making real kind of changes to the labor laws, and that would exist over a long, I mean, on a permanent basis, really, not on this kind of temporary or for the 1,000 days kind of thing. The second aspect that you raised on federalism, I mean, almost, you know, different states have different laws. Now, I don't really have a problem with that, Sarthak. I think for a lot of these things, I think it should be completely decentralized. In fact, I would say remove all of the central labor laws and then let states decide. And you know, according to me, the way that it can actually pan out, if you don't have any union interference in the states and the way they make labor laws, would be that the state which has the most friendly regulations will attract both firms and labor. So there's two aspects here. Now, let's say a state goes on one extreme, which is that it becomes too business friendly and has zero protection for laborers. Now, that might, you know, that might actually attract investments in terms of factories, but it will not attract labor, right? Because no one wants to work in a place which has such, which has zero protections. There's some other states which might go completely labor centric. So it might attract labor, but it will not attract any investment from firms. So the state which can find that balance between the two. And by the way, this is like one of those Nash equilibrium games where both players, that is the firms and laborers, will know how the other one is thinking. As in, if a firm knows that a particular state is being too firm-friendly and anti-labor, it knows that, yes, it can invest there, but it will not attract any labor. And if it can't attract labor, then it cannot run its operations, which means it doesn't win from all of this, right? So even in the firm's interest, it's that there should be some kind of balance. And same with the laborers. I mean, if you have a state which is extremely protective of labor, but gives zero incentive for firms, then it, you know, they know that they will not get any job. Essentially, that's what it comes down to. So I think when you have a competitive federalism, and it's very important that it's competitive federalism, but it's not a race to the bottom kind of scenario. But I think market forces here, that is both on the firm side and on the labor side, can find that balance. But you need time. You can't do this overnight. You can't do this through ordinances. You can't do this through, you know, kind of knee-jerk reactions that has been there. So you need time to think through these and time to see how the effect plays out. And then, you know, keep fine-tuning this knob of public policy, right? So that's one aspect of it. And the other kind of really important point that you raised, the third one, is on policy certainty. Yeah, so you're right that policy certainty matters. But I don't know. I mean, I've read some of those reports, but I don't know if labor is unimportant. I think it's, you know, you could say that there are a lot of things which are important for when a firm invests. Labor is definitely one of them. The other would be land. The other would be, yeah, do you have political stability? Do you have ease of doing business? How easy it is to get a permission to set up a factory? Then whether can, you know, the functioning of the justice system? Can a particular contract be actually enforced? All of these are important. I mean, I don't think it's one against the other, right? All of them come together in you know, they're all ingredients in that perfect dish, which makes it easy for businesses to thrive and for people to be employed. So it's not really one against the other, that labor laws are less important than something else or something else is more important than the other. But so all of that matters. But only one, as a side note and probably as a joke, until now we've had complete policy certainty with labor laws, right? That it was always backward and it was always archaic and it was always complex. Now at least you're having policy uncertainty, but probably in a nice way, that things are changing.
So this is a nice quote. And I think with this, we should probably conclude our discussion on labor regulations and the reforms that we have been talking about recently. And that's the different states have unleashed. So thank you for joining us. Thank you, Anupam.
Thanks, Arthur.
If you liked our show, don't forget to check out other interesting podcasts on the IVM network. You can tune into them on the IVM Podcast app, ivmpodcast.com, or wherever you listen to your podcasts. You can also follow IVM on social media. The handle is @IVMPodcasts on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. And hey, if you'd like to dive into Takshashila's research on technology, strategy, and economic affairs, check us out at our Twitter handle @TakshashilaInst. Or our website, takshashila.org.in.
I hope you enjoyed that show. So another really fun week on the network. I don't know if you saw this, but Varun Thakur was on Advertising is Dead. That was a really, really fun episode. Besides that, we've had some great guests all over the place. We had Ram Madhvani on Cyrus Says. We had Saurabh Mukherjee, a legend in the finance space. He was on Paisa Vaisa. He and Anupam have co-written a book, so definitely do check out that episode and go buy their book too. I mean, like, that would be another great thing to do. Uncle Pleasant had a really, really cool episode with hosts of our other show, Mr. and Mrs. Bingewatch, Anirudh and Janice. They were talking about celebrity culture and how that's progressed for the last few years. And yeah, it's just been a really, really great week. One episode I do want to shout out, a couple of weeks ago, Pulia Bazi did an episode which was just amazing. They were talking about the letters between Mahatma Gandhi and Rabindranath Tagore. Do check those out. Those are really good. And with that, hope to see you again next week.
Hi, my name is Anupam Gupta. I'm B50 on Twitter. I am the host of Paisa Paisa, the show that talks money. On my show, I speak to experts from every field of money and finance, from stock markets, equities, debt funds, credit cards, life insurance, every possible area of money and finance that you can think of. We even did an episode on cryptocurrency. I've got fantastic guests from mutual funds to personal finance experts everywhere, robo-advisory, startups, just name it, we've got it. At Paisa Paisa, we help you make smart decisions about money. You work hard for money. Now make your money work hard for you. New episodes out every Monday, and you can listen to my show on the IVM Podcast app or any other podcasting app that you have.